We begin with the order of confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, creator of darkness and night, word of truth, wind sweeping over the waters. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. God, our rock and refuge, we pour out our hearts before you. We have known you, but have not always loved you. We have wounded one another and sinned against you. We have not always recognized the Holy Spirit dwelling in each of us. Remember your covenant. Renew your creation. Restore us, that we might proclaim your good news to all. Amen. The voice of the Lord is upon the waters. God has spoken. The time of grace is now. In Jesus, the reign of God has come near. By the authority of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. You are God's beloved. Amen. Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all,
Everlasting God, you give strength to the weak and power to the faint. Make us agents of your healing and wholeness, that your good news may be made known to the ends of your creation. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Gospel according to Mark. Glory to you, O Lord. As soon as Jesus and the disciples left the synagogue, they entered the house of Simon and Andrew with James and John. Now Simon's mother-in-law was in bed with a fever, and they told him about her at once. He came and took her by the hand and lifted her up. Then the fever left her, and she began to serve them. That evening at sunset, they brought to him all who were sick or possessed with demons, and the whole city was gathered around the door. And he cured many who were sick with various diseases, cast out many demons, and he would not permit the demons to speak because they knew him. In the morning, while it was still very dark, he got up and went out to a deserted place. And there he prayed. And Simon and his companions hunted for him. When they found him, they said to him, "Everybody is searching for you." He answered, "Let's go on to the neighboring towns, so that I may proclaim my message there also, for that is what I came out to do." And he went throughout Galilee, proclaiming the message in their synagogues and casting out demons. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Well, all right, here we are at this journey in the Epiphany season so far. We started off with the baptism of Jesus, in which people were witnessing the heavens being torn apart and a spirit like a dove descending and a voice from the cloud that came to Jesus as he came up out of the water saying, "You are my son, the beloved. With you, I am well pleased." Some of the disciples of John gathered there, witnessed this, and they themselves later became disciples of Jesus. The next week, we heard about Jesus beginning to call his disciples, calling Philip and Nathanael being stunned that Jesus says he saw him under the fig tree before they even approached him, which led Nathanael to claim to Jesus, "You are the Son of God." To which Jesus responds, "Well, is that all it took? You're going to see a lot bigger things than that." In the following week, we heard the calling of four more disciples, more famous ones, of James and John, Andrew and Simon Peter, who immediately leave their nets to follow. In another gospel's take on the calling of Peter, Jesus approaches them while they are calling it a day after a lack of success in fishing, and Jesus tells them to cast their nets on the other side of the boat, to which Peter reluctantly agrees. But in doing so, the net is full to the breaking point, to which Peter, then in encountering Christ, basically says, "Just leave me alone. Leave me to my life. I don't want this." But of course, that is not what happens. Peter becomes one of the most amazing disciples of Jesus, the life of which we are going to hear a lot more of and spend time with in this coming Lenten season. Then last week, we heard of Jesus teaching with such authority that the crowds who were gathering around to hear him are astonished. And this is followed up with an account of a man coming with an unclean spirit into the synagogue, to which Jesus then, in this convulsing man, commands this unclean spirit to come out of him. And now, these people there start looking at each other and say, "What is this?" And now today, we hear from the Gospel of Mark the text about Jesus going to the house of Peter and Andrew and Simon Peter's mother-in-law. Yes, Peter was married. And she is ill with a fever, and Jesus simply touches her, and she is made well. This is followed up by the actions of the text we heard last week when word is spreading like wildfire that Jesus healed an unclean spirit in the synagogue, and now every person with a disease, a possession, a mental issue, or some force is now getting word that where this Jesus is at, and they've all starting to show up outside the home, outside the door of Simon and Andrew. And we are told that Jesus cures all these people, but the crowds keep coming and word keeps spreading, and finally Jesus has to escape. If you are a disciple of Jesus, what now is going through your mind? What is it with this guy that he's doing these signs, these miracles, these impossible things that not only are people changed, but it seems as though the forces of nature are altered by what is going on and emanating from this man, this rabbi, this teacher, this Messiah? What is all this going to mean? What is going through the disciples' minds? I've thought about that many times, this whole issue. That their journey with Jesus sometimes is knowing, sometimes it's insightful, sometimes it's being flabbergasted, sometimes it's being stunned with what happens around Jesus. That they are constantly getting a shift of priority, constantly witnessing a showdown with the religious authorities, constantly witnessing Jesus stumping those same Pharisees and Sadducees with his teachings and answers to their questions. And then even later on, hinting that the outcome is not going to be some victory as the disciples think of it, but rather that Jesus will be killed, he will be murdered, he will be crucified. I wonder how many times the disciples themselves just sat and thought, "What have I gotten myself into? What have I gotten myself into?" Maybe we have had similar experiences of making decisions to do certain actions in our lives, and then we wonder what in the world we have gotten ourselves into. I think one example of this may be when we encounter a person in need, and we wonder how to best help that person or that situation. How do we make decisions in that moment to simply go on our way or to stop and help or just what? And what is the best Christian and safe response in those moments? I've told the story that one time years ago, I was serving my congregation in Chillicothe and working extremely late one evening. and it was well past midnight, and I was driving home, which was not too far away, and as I was going down the hill, I noticed a car was off the road into a ditch. Its lights were still on. Now, this was a severely sloped ditch, not a simple ditch, and no car was going to be able to simply back out of that on its own. It also looked like the accident had just happened. I wanted to go home, but I thought I needed to stop. And so I stopped. I went up to the car to find a woman in tears in the passenger side, saying when I asked her if I could help, she said, "Yes, but we need to be careful because my boyfriend is very, very upset, making all kinds of threats, and that he drove this car purposely into the ditch. He got out. He's now hiding around here in some bushes or trees, and he's coming back. He's really upset, and I do not know what's going to happen." I got to tell you, in that moment, I thought, what in the world have I gotten myself into? I was stopping to maybe help somebody that might have been in a simple car wreck, a fender bender, only discovered that I was walking in the midst of some potential crime scene, some domestic violence dispute. At that point, I just kind of wanted to sneak back into my car and say, "Okay, well, I hope it goes well for you both." In reality, I ended up driving her to a safe place. But it's one of those times where you realize you've got yourself into a situation where you question, why did you do what you did? This is often the case when we are asked to do things, to join things, which may be out of our comfort level. I often say that when we enter a room, we often pay attention to where the exit doors are in our minds. And that's certainly true in a way when we make a commitment. I think we always want to know, where are the exit doors in case I want to get out of this? I think in being a Christian, there's part of the faith that can fire within us that might ask the same questions, from how do I get out of this, or just what have I gotten myself into, to I can't believe that I got myself in to be a part of this. Sometimes it might be a thrilling question because it's like a roller coaster ride and the highs feel so exciting, but yet the lows seem so scary. And sometimes we just want to get off the ride. Sometimes it might be because the air of challenge, the situation, has grown a little bit more than we are comfortable with, and we like to simply slip out the back door silently. We may be in a situation where we feel the Spirit is leading us to do one thing, but our minds and bodies want to resist and push it away. Perhaps in a way to keep it real, to keep it practical, to possibly stay with the known versus the unknown, to play it safe rather than be bold in our faith and the potential consequences of those actions. It is an understandable dilemma. These past few weeks in the callings of the disciples we have talked about a few times, we've heard about this wrestling with such decisions and how sometimes just wrestling with wrestling in and of itself can be the challenge. We want so much of the world to be black and white versus all these shades of gray. But wrestling is part and parcel of life in the faith. As they often say, it's not the destination, it is the journey. And the journey of faith means highs and lows, questions and answers, comfort and challenge, brokenness and forgiveness, difficult choices, relationships that are not easy to maintain, but still seeking to view one another as a child of God. We are in good company. The call of those 12 disciples, the call we hear in this Epiphany season, did not make their lives easier. How about you? Have you thought about your faith in ways you might honestly ask the question, just what have I gotten myself into? Or maybe we're even sometimes more poignant to say, God, what have you gotten me into? God, why is this happening this way? I'm trying to do what you want me to do, and now look at things. None of us sees the end of things completely while in the midst of working it. As the Apostle Paul once said, now we only see into a mirror dimly, pointing to a vision that someday we will see with clarity. It is a comfort and challenge to know that God is with us through these things. But God's presence does not necessarily mean things will be easier. Often, contrary to my own hopes, my faith makes things harder, not easier. I think that is a human response for many of us. So as you look at your life, your travels, your journey, what have you gotten yourselves into? And how is God a part of that equation? Amen.
Thank you.
Let us confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We continue with the prayers of intercession. As we celebrate Christ embodied in human form, we pray for God's blessing on the church, the world, and all of creation. Everlasting God, you bring your healing power to the church. Give your church a spirit of unity and prayer, that we discern your way for us and the world. God of grace, receive our prayer. Creator of the ends of the earth, you make the grass grow and send rain for soil. Bring your creation into harmony and balance. God of grace, receive our prayer. God without equal, your steadfast love endures forever. Bring the leaders, elected officials, and peacekeepers of our towns and countries into understanding and unity. We remember those in places of war this day. Guide leaders to serve with compassion and understanding. God of grace, receive our prayer. God who strengthens, you lift up your hand with any who are suffering. Heal those who are brokenhearted and strengthen the weak and be with all in need. God of grace, receive our prayer. God who gives power to the faint, challenge us to share the faith stories of what God has done in our lives. Open us to receive the unique ways God is at work in your people, especially whose perspectives challenge our own. God of grace, receive our prayer. God who calls each star by name, remember all who have died. Shelter all who mourn with your mercy and care, and give us hope in your promised salvation. God of grace, receive our prayer. Knowing the Holy Spirit intercedes for us, we offer these prayers and the silent prayers of our hearts in the name of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And now may God, who named you, Christ, who claimed you, and the Holy Spirit, who dwells in you, bless you and remain with you forever. Amen. Go in peace. You are God's beloved. Thanks be to God.